Over a period of 23 years, a string of murders was committed that entertained millions. There were murders in Egyptian tombs.
Why, what are you...
Murders at the circus. Murders at the opera. From New York to Shanghai, people were mysteriously killed on land, at sea, and in the air. Yet baffling as these crimes were, every killer was caught by the incredible cunning and relentless determination of just one man. Lieutenant Charlie Chan of the Honolulu Police. From 1926 to 1949, through one serial and 46 features, this patient, polite, philosophical Chinese gentleman solved more cases than any other detective in movie history. And he did it with primarily one weapon, his brains. For example, Charlie Chan at the opera in 1936.
The fact that Madame Borelli in Wings during aria, final link in chain of evidence. You are murderous. You were only one who knew Gravel planned to sing Mephisto Roll tonight. Later, standing in Wings, recognized voice, not that of husband. Instinctive curiosity forced you to husband's dressing room to investigate. You discover him unconscious, so avail self of perfect opportunity to avenge intrigue which caused you so much humiliation.
Is this some ridiculous attempt to save your face, Mr. Chan?
Humble countenance, merely facing facts. That same belt you wore with costume earlier tonight?
Why, no. The wardrobe department sent me this because the clasp on the other was broken.
Strange.
Have original belt here with clasp in most perfect condition.
Where did you get that?
Found hidden in cushion of chaise longue in your dressing room. Observe, stain of blood on the inside lining. Prove definitely you concealed knife on person after murder of husband.
You're right.
Compared to today's movie heroes, Charlie Chan might seem out of it. A portly, middle-aged man with a dozen kids to support. A hero who never kissed a girl, never threw a punch, hardly ever fired a shot. Come to think of it, compared to yesterday's movie heroes, Chan seems out of it. Yet there was something about him that made audiences come back again and again and again. What was it that gave Charlie Chan such a unique place in film history? He was not an overnight success. As Charlie himself once said, a gem is not polished without rubbing, nor a man perfected without trials. The same might be said for a film series, too. Like so many memorable movie characters, Chan was born in a book. His creator, Earl Derr Biggers, died in 1933, having completed 6 Charlie Chan novels. They sold over 5 million copies and were serialized in the Saturday Evening Post. One book, The Keeper of the Keys, was adapted into a Broadway play in 1933 and starred William Harrigan as Inspector Chan. But it took a while for Chan to make it in the movies. His first try was in a 1926 Pathé serial, which starred Aline Ray and Walter Miller. In that first and brief outing, Chan was played by Japanese actor George Kuwa. 2 years later, Chan was a major character in Universal's The Chinese Parrot. And again, a Japanese, Kamiyama Sojin, played him. A year later, Chan was reduced to merely a walk-on in a Warner Baxter starrer, Behind That Curtain. This time, he was played by an Englishman, E.L. Park. Finally, in 1931, 20th Century Fox cast Swedish-born Warner Oland as Chan, and the magic started. Oland was the personal choice of Mrs. Earl Derr Biggers, even though he had made his reputation playing Oriental heavies opposite Pearl White. Now he seemed to relish the chance to be a good guy at last. Perhaps the Chan Oland brought to the screen was a warm, kindly, courteous sleuth whose sharp eyes and intellect overlooked nothing, no matter how seemingly insignificant.
Contradiction, please. Look.
That other car. They must have gone for a doctor. Maybe we can help.
That's nothing. Too late for doctor. This man shot to death.
Shot?
Gee, Pop, I'll bet the chauffeur did it and escaped in that other car.
Is possible. No careful attempt to destroy footprints.
But why would the chauffeur bother to do that? They'll suspect him anyway.
Perhaps not worried about own footprints.
Rhinestone suggests presence of lady.
Oland captivated audiences everywhere and subsequently did the role in 16 Chan films. When Oland died in 1938, the series continued without interruption with Sidney Toler taking over. Toler appeared in 21 movies and was succeeded in 1947 by Roland Winters, who did 6. But it was Warner Oland who set the pattern. All who followed were really doing Warner Oland's Chan, and none did it better than he. Just what kind of man was Chan? Well, as we said, he was a man of manners.
Once you've ever seen. Meet Sheriff Fletcher.
Most honored to meet illustrious sheriff.
The honorable father once say, politeness, golden key that opened many doors.
Right.
May humbly request one more favor.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank
you so much. And Chan was a man of wisdom, with a seemingly endless arsenal of aphorisms.
Confucius say, luck, happy combination of foolish accidents. Truth, like football, receive many kicks before reaching goal.
What is it, Pop?
Envelope, like skin of banana, must be removed to digest contents.
She thinks I'm mad. Everybody thinks I'm mad.
A very old Chinese wise man once say, madness, twin brother of genius, because each live in a world created by own ego. One, sometime mistaken for other.
With over 46 features, a little repetition was inevitable.
Many unfortunate people.
But Charlie, the evidence.
It is best. We are destroying web of spider. Now let us find spider.
Finding web of spider does not prove which spider spin web. Small things sometimes tell large stories. And little things tell big story. Little things tell story.
If want wild bird to sing, do not put him in cage.
If you want wild bird to sing, do not put him in cage.
Even though Chan never made a pass at a pretty girl in his pictures, his virility was never questioned.
9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, including humble self. Pass. Thank you so much.
Number One's son, played by Ki Lu, was often on the receiving end of Chan's pithy remarks.
In future, remember, tongue often hang man quicker than rope.
You got here just in time. How about a little advance on my allowance? I'm almost broke.
Puppy love, very expensive pastime.
While other members of Chan's family occasionally got into the act, it was Number One's son who was most often involved in running down false clues, usually in ridiculous disguises.
Good morning, Mr. Chan.
How did you know it was me?
I never forget a face.
Don't give me away. I'm on a hot trail.
You must be. Something's burning.
Hiya, Sue. We're detectives.
Incidentally, that was not one of Chan's offspring in the carriage. Number one son was not always used just for laughs. Sometimes he performed other useful chores. We have seen Chan as a man of manners, wisdom, and one man's family. He was also a man of science.
Observe hole through which murderer insert tube of deadly gas into sound box.
All very interesting, Mr. Chan. But how could your murderer have broken the tube while Barry was playing?
Murderer, very ingenious. He knew scientific fact that very thin glass vibrate to certain sound. We'll demonstrate. While playing, Mr. Barry says directly over sound length, inhale deadly gas, die almost instantly.
You have established a motive, Mr. Chan.
Motive for murders of professor and son, very clear.
What about the handkerchief?
Chemical analysis of same prove face of murdered man treated with solution of quinine sulfate.
For what reason?
Quinine sulfate, when exposed to rays of ultraviolet lamp, produce mysterious light which accompany apparition.
But most of all, Charlie Chan was the detective supreme, the master of deductive reasoning.
$1 million. Everything is now clear. The bartender steals the bones and commits the murders. Then he becomes full of fright. He knows he cannot escape the police chain that was so tight around Monte Carlo. So what does he do? He takes a pistol, point him here, makes the suicide. Voila! The case, it is now finished.
Contradiction, please. Only Rogers finished. Case still open.
Come on.
Note. Bullet enter head behind left ear.
Oui.
Also gun found in left hand.
Oui.
Yet position of coffee cup and pot indicate victim right-handed.
It's too true. Obviously, the left hand does not make the suicide for the right-handed man. But the bonds, Monsieur Chan, do they not prove he is the thief?
Prove only that thief was here.
And plant the bonds and the gun
on dead man who cannot defend self. Regard, chair overturned. In struggle to avoid murderer.
Problem. What was the murder weapon? Solution? Easy.
Look for scissors among ladies' effects.
Okay. Any particular kind?
Straight edge indicate use of long desk shears.
You mean it might have been used as a death weapon?
If closed, would leave wound as described by police surgeon?
After turning up evidence others had overlooked, Chan would catch the killer by setting a trap, sometimes using himself for bait, as in Charlie Chan in London, 1934.
blank cartridges in pistol.
In Charlie Chan in Egypt, 1935, Chan sprung his trap this way.
Please. Do not move. Place knife on table.
What's going on?
Charlie's called all the suspects together. He's going to produce the murderer.
He's going to produce...
In most of his later pictures, Chan wrapped up his cases by bringing all the suspects, and that included just about everyone in the picture, into one room. This way, the audience had a last chance to try and guess who'd done it before Charlie nailed him. It was corny, familiar, but fun. Here's the final scene from Charlie Chan in Reno, a 1939 film, and Sidney Toler's second appearance as Chan.
Have been called together because each of you had very strong reason for hating Mrs. Bentley. One of you had motive powerful enough to kill. Here is lady whose husband was stolen from her by murdered woman 5 years ago. Here is young man, blindly in love until eyes rudely opened by ugly insult in public. Miss Wells, impulsive young lady in love with doctor, has admitted she would have killed Mrs. Bentley if given sufficient provocation.
Just a minute. Just a minute. If you're taking them from left to right, you just skipped your friend, Mrs. Whitman. She's still the only one found with the body.
We'll neglect no one. Here is husband, most anxious to get rid of wife.
Only in a legal, straightforward manner.
Think Dr. Ainsley can furnish answer to that.
What do you mean?
Doctor said had known Mrs. Bentley only 3 weeks, yet signed false certificate on death of first husband, Wayne Russell, 3 years ago.
False certificate? You mean she killed him?
Canceled checks prove Mrs. Bentley paid Dr. Ainsley large sums of money to keep guilty secret.
If I'd known that...
Didn't you?
No.
Then please explain why you visit Mrs. Bentley with acid bottle.
How did you know?
We know you were here.
I came to disfigure her. When Mrs. Whitman arrived at the hotel and I saw what happened, I realized that Jean was going to ruin her life, the same as she'd ruined mine. All the hate I'd felt came back to me. I got the acid from the doctor's office.
But found lady's face protected by beauty mask.
That's it. Then you grabbed the scissors and stabbed her. Mrs. Russell, I arrest you in the name of the law.
I didn't kill her. When Jean saw the acid, she grabbed for it. Said she'd give me a dose of my own medicine. I kept her from getting it, but some of the acid was spilled. When I left her, she was very much alive. But now I understand what happened. When she couldn't get the $5,000 from Bentley, the doctor killed her. He didn't.
Missing $100 bills found in doctor's room prove he was here on night of murder.
Well, what if he was? If he was blackmailing Mrs. Bentley, would he be stupid enough to kill his meal ticket?
You keep out of this.
I won't keep out of it.
Excuse. Miss Wells, very calm young lady, except where doctor is concerned.
What are you doing now, accusing her?
Have accused no one as yet. Merely search for truth.
What about Mrs. Russell? She admits coming up here with the acid.
And yet you take her word for it that she left without killing her.
Please. Can explain bandage found in room?
Who found it in my room?
Number two sons. Most ambitious amateur sleuth.
A lot of people found scissors in their room, and they were planted by number two son. So what does that prove, Mr. Charlie Chan?
Well, Doc, your sleeve's on fire. Tell,
Stop it! Let go of me! Stop it! Leave me alone! Stop it!
What happened, Charlie?
Merely experiment with liquid smoke. Quite harmless, but highly successful in trapping murderers. Honorable Sheriff.
Well, that is, I did.
The technique was predictable, but the murderer wasn't. Will the real killer please confess?
Did only you and Messenger possess keys?
Yes, I guess so.
Then you are murderer.
Why? You're crazy.
Ordinary thief would break lock on bag or cut leather to open same. You made one mistake when you leave bag in Mr. Rogers' room. You open it with key.
That doesn't prove anything. Anyone could open that lock with a hairpin.
Impossible also to open safe with hairpin and replace bonds.
Why would I do that? If I'd taken the bonds, I'd have sold them, wouldn't I?
Not if bonds stolen to prevent discovery of previous theft. Mystery of young lady's expensive luxuries now explained. Months ago, you steal bonds from employer's safe to buy affection of former mannequin. Last night, when danger of exposure arises, you commit murders, then replace in safe enough bonds to conceal former robberies. Today, you go to Hotel Regal, plant evidence in Mr. Rogers' room, then murder him when he returns to unexpectedly find you.
I didn't, I tell you.
I didn't do it. I didn't.
The same gun was used in each crime.
That isn't true. Rogers was shot with a different gun.
Thank you so much. Only police and murderer could know same.
Gordon, you didn't do it. You couldn't have.
Yes, I did it all right.
Excellent reason to conceal for...
It seemed the most dangerous thing anybody could do was put Charlie Chan on a case. Once he began his investigation, the bodies really started to drop.
Unfortunately, dead.
Chan's knack for bringing on disaster didn't sit well with some clients. The client in this case was Pat Patterson, better known as Mrs. Charles Boyer.
Trying into our affairs has brought us nothing but misfortune. First it was Barry, and now it's Tom.
What happened to Tom?
The attempt made on life tonight in Namete tomb. Two bullets in chest.
We look to you for protection, which you haven't given us. I'll have to ask you to leave, Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan, I can't help but feel that Alice is right in holding you responsible. You proved that Bone was guilty of the murder of Alan Colby. You knew he made an attempt on Mrs. Lowell's life last night, yet you failed to turn him over to the police.
Most humbly regret very fatal error which cost life of dear old friend.
But it all worked out in the end when Chan uttered the three little words everyone was waiting to hear.
You are a murderer.
Aside from their melodramatic entertainment, the Charlie Chan movies offer an extra kick for film buffs. A surprisingly large number of now famous stars and supporting players were featured in the Chan pictures. Warner Oland's debut as Chan was with a cast that included William Holden, George Brent, and Jason Robards Sr. A young actress named Rita Cancino appeared in a 1935 Chan epic. Later, she changed her name to Hayworth and married a prince, among others.
Excuse, please. Professor Thurston gone long?
He went into look, sir, to see the police.
Oh.
Mr. Chan.
Yes?
I hope Effendi Evans will get well.
Kind thoughts add favorable weight in balance of life and death.
Boris Karloff singing? He did in Charlie Chan at the Opera.
How many times have I told you not to interrupt my singing?
You are a magician named Radini. Cannot forget what you borrowed.
Tall, dark, and young Caesar Romero was in Charlie Chan on Treasure Island, along with Douglas Fowley, old reliable Donald McBride, and sinister Douglas Dumbro. William Demarest didn't have much faith in Chan.
Ask Mr. Chan to come in.
Wait a minute.
You haven't called Chop Suey in on the case, have you, Chief?
J. Carroll Nash looked guilty and was in Charlie Chan at the circus. Later, he played Chan himself in the TV series. Sidney Blackmer was a suspect in Monte Carlo.
Why? Robbery, of course. He was carrying $1 million worth of my bond.
Robert Lowry and Ricardo Cortez added Menace in Reno. Netta Harrigan, now Mrs. Josh Logan, was the unsuspected killer at the opera. The romantic lead opposite Drew Layton in Charlie Chan in London was future Oscar winner Ray Milland.
Why wouldn't you see me this morning when I was down at Richmond's?
Please leave me alone.
But you've got to listen to me. You must give me a chance to explain.
Let me go. Haven't you done enough? Can't you understand I never want to see you again?
With lines like that, no wonder he was driven to drink. The comedy for Chan in Egypt was provided by Steppenfetchit, and they don't make scenes like this anymore.
Ah! If any snowshoe.
You is again. This ain't in no place where you ain't.
This time, Effendi, I have big news for you. What first? Bakshish. Stupid bakshish, stupid.
Well, you might as well go on. I won't let you be getting no more bakshish money out of me.
But wait. Today, I have located the grave of your sacred ancestor. Bakshish. Stupid bakshish.
I know not. But you sure you done found the mummy of my great-great-grandpappy?
Nay. You're great, 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 great,
oh,
great,
you
great,
done great, it great. Too much. Child, I don't believe I'm gonna let you talk me out no more money.
The parade of famous names through the Chan films is almost endless. It includes Robert Young, Alan Mowbray, Victor Jory, Lynn Barry, Catherine DeMille, Bela Lugosi, Leo Carroll, George Zucco, Madge Bellamy, Lon Chaney Jr., Lionel Atwell, and many more. In a Chan picture, a face lurking in the shadows is probably a familiar one to students of Hollywood memorabilia. Some may say the Charlie Chan films are dated, and that's a fair comment. After all, they were part of an era of filmmaking that has long since passed. Yet, despite their age, or maybe because of it, their entertainment value is still high. Their very datedness gives them a certain historical significance.
That we try to avoid here.
Why?
I'm gonna marry your husband, so what? This is 1939, we're modern. Let's talk things over. Besides, there's lots of things I want to...
Well, some things never change. Here and there throughout the Chan films are little flashbacks in time that are fascinating. In 1935, a plane flies over the partially completed Golden Gate Bridge. Or this comment on high-speed travel in 1937.
Well, they've got a big start on you. They're both docks in Hamburg in 7 days.
Race not always won by man who stopped first. Please.
We'll leave tomorrow in company with Hopkins and Cartwright on Clipper.
Honolulu. 18 hours to mainland. Then transcontinental plane from San Francisco. 13 hours across country to New York. Take Zeppelin Hindenburg from Lakehurst, New Jersey. Across Atlantic Ocean to British Harbor, 61 hours.
For journalism students, a brief discourse on the amazing new wire photo service.
Hello, Hudson. Smitty, Chicago Sun speaking. The Gravel picture is coming through.
Okay, Smitty, we're standing by. It'll only be a minute now, Mr. Chan, while they regulate the speed so that the roller holding the picture in Chicago is revolving at the same rate as the roller holding the negative in this cylinder. Here it comes. The two machines are now locked together as one. A small light is traveling over the picture in Chicago. It's an electric eye, that tells this electric eye, over the wire, what it sees. Then this electric eye prints on the negative, in this cylinder, in black and white, what it sees in Chicago. I'll have it developed immediately, Mr. Chan.
Actual newsreel scenes of the 1936 Olympics at Berlin were integrated into Charlie Chan at the Olympics. Included was the thrilling 400-meter relay, where the American team, headed by Jesse Owens, set a new world's record that held until 1960. May have had a tough time recognizing the opera excerpts they heard in Charlie Chan at the Opera. No wonder. It was an original musical sequence written for the picture by none other than Oscar Levant. Margaret Irving was the bewigged prima donna. Give all of you a chance to see if you can outwit the great Chan. Here's a telescope version of Charlie Chan at Treasure Island. Made in 1939, it's considered one of the best of the series because it so ingeniously obscures the real killer. See if you can name him before Chan does.
Care to join us, Mr. Chan?
No, thanks. I've got to walk.
Taking a little stroll, that's the spirit.
Please, I'd like my parachute now.
Why, these planes are perfectly safe, Mr. Chan. Besides, San Francisco reports clear weather ahead.
How far ahead?
Oh, a few hours.
A few hours?
You're not worried, are you, Mr. Chan?
Oh, no.
It's in San Francisco already.
There's the World's Fair, Treasure Island.
Oh, we're going to land.
Oh, it looks like a big wedding cake.
What's that big tower out there?
That's the Chinese pagoda.
No, that's the Tower of the Sun.
It is the Chinese pagoda. The smaller one's the Tower of the Sun.
Oh, I see.
Gee, Pop, I hope Mr. Essence isn't missing any of this. Don't miss the view, Mr. Gregory. It's the fair.
I'll wait and see the one in New York.
You would. I'll take California. Hey, Mr. Essex, come over on this side. Maybe you can see your wife from here. Hey, Mr. Essex, wake up. Paul. Paul? Pop! Hey, Pop! Something's wrong.
Paul.
He must be sick.
Take your seat, please. We're landing. Your seat, please. Something wrong?
Is he...
Dead? Must have been his heart. What's the trouble? Oh, go back to your seats, please. We're about to land. Please be seated.
Would you like to see some of my press clippings? Pete's paper's offering $1,000 to any psychic, phony or otherwise, whose stunts I can't duplicate on the stage of my theater.
And so far, no one's collected, not even the great Dr. Zodiac.
Zodiac?
Yeah, he's a big shot in the spook racket around here.
The only trouble is, he won't fall for our challenge. He won't come out in the open where I can get at him.
Now listen, you two mugs. If you don't mind, I got Charlie up here for a little private conversation. He's heard only once about black magic.
No, most interesting. Sometimes black magic, very close relative to blackmail.
Now who said anything about blackmail?
Why, don't you get it? Those phony psychics dig up the dirt, hand it over to the customers in the seance, then hold them up.
That might be the reason for those three suicides recently. What is it, Pop?
Here. Engage rooms at St. Francis Hotel. And when Mrs. Essex call, say we'll be delayed.
But what's in the note?
Ancient Chinese proverb. Badly misquoted. Should read, do not challenge supernatural unless armed with sword of truth. Dr. Zodiac is native of San Francisco.
Dr. Zodiac is a native of the universe. He knows all things about all people.
Please join me in silent meditation while I seek my control. An Egyptian priestess who passed beyond 3,000 years ago.
For Mr. Chan?
There is someone newly arrived in the spirit world who wishes to get through to Mr. Chan. I will help him. He is a man who was named Paul Essex.
Ask the question that fills your mind, Mr. Chan.
Paul, old friend, Charlie Chan most grieved. Cannot understand death which struck so suddenly.
There was enough poison in Paul Essex's stomach to have polished off 10 men.
But I'd like to help out. We've got to find that briefcase.
Can best help out by disguising self as obedient son.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, I must ask for absolute quiet. Under hypnosis, Miss Cairo becomes a delicate radio receiving apparatus, tuned to every forceful mind.
Thank you. Your eyes closed. You will sleep. I am your control. You will seek the mind I name.
I will seek the mind you name.
All right, give me something. Anything. What have I in my hand?
It is
A ring. A gold wedding ring. In it are engraved words. Foxy love tooth.
Will you please concentrate, Miss Cairo? What do I hold in my hand?
It is... You... There's someone else. I can't go on. I can't. I hear death among us. I'm frightened. There's evil here. Someone here is thinking murder.
Where's my pop?
Now, wait a minute. People can't vanish into thin air. Come on, we've got to find him.
That door's been locked.
Find him, vanish. Look.
Gentlemen, what are you doing in my house?
What have you done to my pop?
You have search warrant?
Come on, Zodiac, open up and talk fast.
Thank you so much. Appreciate bravery.
Where's Charlie? Pop! Pop, don't ever do that again. What have you got there?
Face rubber, beard false. Massive body, an illusion. Elaborate disguise indicate Dr. Zodiac, two other people.
Wait a minute. Do you mean to say that wire framework is used to make a person appear taller?
Exactly.
Then Zodiac could be a woman.
Or the Turk.
Anything possible.
But where is the Turk?
Make disappearance like ghost. Ran into closet. Found blank wall, but no Turk. Zodiac disguise. Hang here.
One of these walls must be false.
Suspicion confirmed. Unfortunate and illegal experiences of many people hidden in these boxes. Information collected from false psychics in many cities.
Organized blackmail.
But Dr. Zodiac, not ordinary criminal. He is man of great ego, with disease known to science as pseudologia fantastica.
Is it serious?
Listen. Pathological liars and swindlers suffer from exaggerated fantasy, unleashed vanity, and great ambition which robs them of caution known to saner men.
Or as Pop would put it, Swellhead gives owner more trouble than indigestion.
Correction, please. Swellhead sometimes give police more cooperation than criminal mistake.
Say, I'll buy that. We might trip Zodiac to his vanity.
Criminal egotists find pleasure in laughing at police.
Say, if we could only give him a chance to laugh at us, that might bring him out in the open, and then... But how are we going to work it?
Suggest artful flattery in form of special challenge from Redini to demonstrate powers before men of science.
That's great, Charlie, and I know my paper will go for it.
My initial endeavor will be to nullify the law of gravity through levitation. An art practiced by the holy men of Tibet, who are credited with being able to project their bodies through space.
Thank you.
Now watch Miss Cairo, and particularly the table. We are under observation by a supercritical jury of witnesses. Nothing below, a beautiful lady above. No wires connected to the table, no mechanical devices. Yet, unless your eyes deceive you, the table and the young lady are rising into the fourth dimension of space, supported by nothing but thin air. Levitation was a religious rite of the ancient world, known to the priests of Chaldea, a guarded secret in the temples of Babylon. A fearsome ceremony of the pagan gods who cried for sacrifice, and before whom victims vanished and disappeared.
In heart. Death instantaneous.
Boy, what a finish for Dr. Zodiac. Who is he, Pop?
the Turk.
Wait a minute. House lights. Everybody stay right where you are. No one is to leave this theater. Have everybody go back to their seats.
Remote body out there.
They're going to stage Regini's act again. Oh. We want all the cooperation you can give us. The person sitting next to you might be the murderer we're looking for.
We'll need volunteer to take place of victim. You will oblige?
What? Me be the murdered man? But I ain't a good subject, Mr. Chan, I ain't.
No.
Watch Miss Cairo, and particularly the table. We are under observation by a supercritical jury of witnesses. Nothing below? No wires descended in the table? No. Device. Yet unless your eyes deceive you, the table and the lady arriving into the fourth dimension of space, supported by nothing but thin air. Levitation was a religious rite of the ancient world, known as the Feast of Chaldea. A guarded secret of the ancient temples of...
Can't come back, wrong. Regini didn't finish his speech. Light! Light! Turn on the light!
Ah! I never forgot that word. How did that happen? Do something.
All right. All right.
Take
it. All right. Get to his dressing room. Why, he's wounded. Get to his dressing room. Call a doctor.
Take it, Claude. He's bleeding.
Come on, come on. Get him to his dressing room.
You will turn off all lights except one on mirror, please. You will read thoughts in my mind until dominant thought of killer comes to you. Concentrate. Close eyes, please. I'm now your control.
You are my control.
Your lips will speak my thoughts as they come to you.
I will speak your thoughts. I get the impression of a strange, mysterious room. There is a man. It is Dr. Zodiac. He has learned secrets of people's lives and uses his information to blackmail them. I see one of his victims. He's in an airplane. He commits suicide because Dr. Zodiac threatens him with disgrace. That man's wife is here in the theater. Her heart is filled with bitterness. There is another woman here who is helping Dr. Zodiac, but she fears him. Only his death can bring her freedom. I see another man here, a rival, who has staked his reputation on unmasking Dr. Zodiac tonight. There is another who fears the loss of his position and prestige because Dr. Zodiac has outwitted him. And a young man, who believes Dr. Zodiac is interfering with his romance, trying to separate him from the girl he loves. There's someone confusing our contact, Mr. Chan.
Go on, please.
Yes, I have your control again. There is a woman who is filled with jealousy and hatred. Dr. Zodiac is trying to influence her. Mr. Chan, there's a mind here that is fighting me, trying to keep your thoughts from me.
Continue, please.
He is frightened, desperate. It is Dr. Zodiac. He is not dead. He is here in this theater.
Zodiac here? Then who is the Turk?
We'll soon learn. Concentrate, please.
The man who was murdered was Dr. Zodiac's servant, who is impersonating him here tonight to throw the police off the trail.
What was motive for murder, please?
The servant was the only one who knew his master's secret. Zodiac killed him to silence him and make the world believe that Dr. Zodiac was dead.
Who is Dr. Zodiac?
It is...
Well, how are you doing? Got it all figured out? Let's see if you're right.
It is... Something is keeping it from me. A control stronger than yours.
Killer is trying to prevent you from reading my thoughts. Make effort, please.
I'm trying. It's coming closer. It's filled with evil, with lots of murder. It's Dr. Zodiac. He's ready to strike again.
Lights, lights!
It's Rodini.
Fred.
My boss.
Otherwise known as Dr. Zodiac. Very clever to have Turk impersonate you at seance and thus avoid suspicion.
Nice work. But you'll never convict me of killing the Turk.
Contradiction, please. We'll demonstrate. Silver tip wand used in floating table illusion, not same as this one, which you carry up sleeve, from which you produce orchid. Mechanism, make most potent murder weapon. Observe. Easy for magician to confuse picture of crime, even to inflicting wound in own shoulder to avert suspicion.
All right, men, take them out.
So sorry.
I didn't know, Mr. Chan. I never even suspected.
Rodini sure was covered up, but we licked this case.
Appreciate valuable assistance, but please remember, obvious clues like tricks in magic usually prove deceptive.
You bet. From now on, I'll be just like...
Have we seen the last of Charlie Chan in motion pictures? Who knows? Hollywood wise men once say, movies that bring people to box office probably never die for long. Thank you so much.